Good afternoon. Spring is just over a week away, but if you've been outside today, you wouldn't know it. A cold snap sweeping its way through New South Wales, spreading a fresh dusting of snow over large parts of the state. And while some have made the most of it, it has caused a headache for motorists. Major highways closed or backed up for hours this morning because of black ice. Thankfully now, they are all now reopened and the traffic has cleared. Sophie Walsh was at Mount Lambie near Lithgow and filed this report a little earlier at the height of the drama.
Well, this was pretty special to wake up to. Winter giving us one final gorgeous icy blast. Snow falling across the Blue Mountains and parts of the Central West, as well as far north as Armidale and Guyra. Residents in Blackheath and Katoomba making the most of the blanket of white which fell throughout the night, many finding their cars covered in the morning and trees dusted with icing sugar snow. In other parts like Orange, where it was forecast, there wasn't quite enough rain, so it was cold enough for snow but not wet enough. That cold front has now moved out to sea, so we aren't expecting any more of the white stuff, but it has created hazardous conditions on our roads. The Great Western Highway between Katoomba and Mount Victoria closed in both directions due to black ice. Same for the Bells line between Bell and Lithgow. And while this might feel like a bit of a shock to the system, it's actually pretty normal for this time of year. It's not unusual for us to see snow falling into September and even October.
Okay, let's get an update on the weather situation now with Amber. And Amber, large parts of the state woke to freezing temperatures this morning.
They sure did. Good afternoon, Davina. Well, Sydney firstly waking up this morning to a low of 7 degrees in the city in Terry Hills. But let's take a look at that wind chill. It felt more like zero. The airport only felt like 1 degree. Bankstown felt like 3, while Penrith felt like 4 degrees. Now, it did warm up. We enjoyed mostly sunny skies today, reaching tops of 15 to 18 degrees across the Sydney basin. But we also saw moderate to gusty southwesterly winds sticking around, and they reached more than 50 kilometres an hour in Kurnell, the harbour and at Little Bay. So what that meant was the wind chill also stuck around. So at lunchtime, it only felt like 7 degrees at the airport, 9 in the city and just 10 degrees in Camden, Bankstown and Campbelltown. Let's take a look around New South Wales. As we know, very, very cold. There were plenty of sub-zero temperatures this morning, plummeting to -7 at Thredbo Top Station, -3 in Goulburn, -2 in Bathurst and -1 in Mudgee, Orange and Braidwood, as we know, bringing snow to most of those places. But after a 10-day run with not much rain, it is back to the classic 2022 pattern of take an umbrella anywhere, anytime, as most of the state is expecting rain over the next few days. I'll be back with that forecast soon, Davina.
That's standard pattern. Okay, Amber, thank you. Well, there is relief for John Farnham's family, friends and fans, with the much-loved singer now stable in a Melbourne hospital after nearly a marathon 12-hour surgery to remove a tumour from his mouth. Mimi Becker has the story.
John Farnham is recovering in ICU after a marathon surgery that went for 11 and a half hours. Just a day after his cancer battle became public, it's been revealed part of the singer's jaw had to be removed and reconstructed as part of the operation. His wife, Jill, saying in a statement, the cancerous tumour was located in his mouth and it has been successfully removed. There is still a long road of recovery and healing ahead of us, but we know John is up for that task. The 73-year-old is in a stable condition. Close family friend Gaynor Wheatley sharing her huge sense of relief.
It was a big team. I think at one stage there were 26 surgeons. So they are our heroes. They're our rock stars, let me tell you.
The family thanked the doctors and nurses for a magnificent outcome, revealing John Farnham will have to stay in hospital while he undergoes post-operative care and possibly more treatment.
There will be a period of time in hospital just recovering from the surgery, and then there'll be ongoing treatment to make sure we've, you know, got it all.
The family say they've been overwhelmed by the love and support from everyone across Australia and that John will be blown away.
The cost of living pressures are biting hard, putting the federal government under intense pressure to make genuine progress on wage growth at its upcoming Jobs and Skills Summit. Our politics reporter Eliza Edwards has more for us in Canberra. Eliza, good afternoon. This situation is so much at the forefront of Australia right now.
Absolutely, Davina. With inflation set to peak at almost 8% later this year and wages only growing at 2.7%, people are wide-eyed about their pay packets not keeping pace with the rising cost of living. Almost two-thirds of Australians now expect a cut to their real income this year. That's according to a survey conducted by Resolve Strategic for Nine's newspapers, the Sydney Morning Herald and The Age. The issue will be front and centre at next week's Jobs and Skills Summit here in Canberra. But what's problematic is businesses and union leaders are at odds over the best ways to actually boost wages. The Prime Minister was trying to set expectations today, warning there won't be a silver bullet.
So we will be introducing a budget in October that, for example, will reduce the cost of medicine. We have a plan to reduce the cost of childcare. So there are things that the government can do. It can't solve everything.
Why isn't the Albanese cabinet bursting out of that room full of ideas for struggling Australians who right now do not have an answer to increasing power prices, to mortgages that are going up next month, and to electricity bills and the cost of groceries?
Davina, the survey also shows only 14% of voters believe a shortage in skilled workers should be a top issue at the summit, and only 20% want a boost in migration to be a main priority. So while businesses might be crying out for staff, many Australians are more concerned with their own hip pocket pain.
Let's hope they hear it. Okay, Eliza, thank you. Well, learning on the job, the nation's biggest training hub for tradies has opened in Sydney's northwest, and it's set to change the way we all learn and teach. The $157 million facility, unveiled today at Meadowbank TAFE, will see 3,000 carpentry, plumbing and electrotech students upskilled every year.
Many of these apprenticeships that take place here will now have apprentices who not just work together but train together as well.
Can you believe the 12,000 square metre facility allows enough space to construct a full-scale building and plumbing pits? It's been 6 months since Russia launched its invasion of Ukraine, and after more than 5,000 deaths, there still seems to be no end in sight. And we're joined this afternoon by Dr. Olga Alinikova, a senior lecturer at UTS School of Communications. Doctor, thank you so much for your time. I remember vividly speaking to you on the day Russia invaded in February. I've thought a lot about you since. Did you expect that we would still be here?
I never actually expected that this invasion will happen. In the first instance, I was optimistic that Russia will never do that, but, you know, my projections were wrong.
I remember you telling us about your grandparents, that they live in Kyiv. How are they and where are they now?
So my grandparents are still in Kyiv, in the same apartment block in the city centre. I actually talked to my grandma yesterday, and she said that situation is improving. She was sending me the message that Kyiv is doing okay, that a lot of people are returning back, that streets are busy, summer is nice, the weather is nice. So, you know, this sends me a message that people just get used to living under such conditions, unfortunately.
How do you handle it here, knowing that that's home?
I never thought that the topic of refugees, you know, will actually be shared by my own experience, by my own family. As my parents-in-laws, they're refugees now here in Australia, my mom as well. And I never thought that the topic of refugee will become my personal as well story. I have some friends who came down to Australia as well, and they're doing fantastically well here. You know, they're looking for a job, they're doing English classes, so they're trying their best to integrate.
It's Ukraine's Independence Day today. The government banned celebrations, though, because of the Russian threat. That's difficult, but also understanding, I guess.
We can't say there's nothing happening, right, on the Independence Day. There are some still efforts to have a celebration and try to celebrate, I think, not just the territory, right? Not just the independence from the Soviet rule, but celebrate all these amazing people who are fighting and who are defending Ukrainian territory, who are giving their lives and whose families are, you know, shattered across the whole world, escaping the shellings and bombings in their home state.
And to celebrate that strength and the endurance that they've suffered throughout this entire time. I guess the question ultimately is, what do you see as victory? Are you hopeful that one day life can return to normal, whatever normal will be?
My hope is that, you know, Ukraine will negotiate from a position of strength and, yeah, we will return the territories back. Again, how achievable is that? How realistic is that? That's the big question.
Well, more than anything, I hope your family stays safe. Thank you so much for chatting to us again.
Thank you.